Hello and welcome to Monte Carlo and the PokerStars.com European Poker Tour. This is season 2 of the PokerStars.com European Poker Tour, and we've frequented some truly amazing places along the way, from Barcelona to right here in Monte Carlo. We've been joined by 2,050 of the world's best poker players, and they in turn have generated a staggering 9.8 million euros in prize money. Thus far, we've crowned 6 EPT champions, but there's only one ace in the pack. There can only be one grand final champion in Monte Carlo. 298 players entered Season 2's final event, and 290 have been eliminated. Former World Series champions, former EPT champions, and reigning Monte Carlo champion, all out. And that leaves us with eight. Eight players remain in the grand final of the richest poker tournament Europe has ever seen. A total prize pool just short of 3 million euros has been created, and the winner here will take home some 900,000 euros. Who will win it? It'll be one of these eight. These, ladies and gentlemen, are the finalists. Eight players all vying for that monstrously outrageous prize. In seat one from Canada is Mark Karam. He's in fifth position at the moment. Smart dresser, smart player.
My name is Mark Karam. I'm 25 and I'm from Ottawa, Canada. This is the most beautiful place I've ever seen in my life. And this is my second event and I've made the final table, so it's going very, very well so far. Well, I'm really good at sensing other people's weaknesses when they raise. I like to come over top.
In seat two, a monster. I'm afraid to say his name in public, Marcel Lusk.
And the player in seat three.
A 19-year-old in seat three from the University of Georgia in third place, somewhat of an unknown, Jeff Williams. Now here's a man back on top of his game after a bit of a lull, Ross Boatman. Bottom chip stack, but he's here to do the business.
I'm Ross Boatman, I'm a year old, and I'm British. I started playing poker when I was about 10 years old. My big brother taught me how to play. I've been playing ever since. Gambled my way through school, through college. I can't play tight. It's a beautiful day in Monte Carlo, and I'm in the final of what must be the biggest ever poker tournament in European history. And, you know, if I get off to a good start, I've got a chance.
From France.
That he has, as does Thierry Casals. He's our chip leader going into this final day. Another Englishman vying for the big prize is Arshad Hussein. He's been short stacked loads of times and still hanging on.
My name's Arshad Hussein. I'm from Accrington. That's in England. And I'm 31. I qualified through it's a poker star scheme where you collect points as you play. The more you play, the more points you get. I'm over the moon now. I mean, I can't describe how good I feel now.
The happiness the EPT brings from England, Fraser Dunphy. He's actually hailing from Leeds and he needs to get busy. Seventh position at the moment.
Second best chip stack to start.
Now making our final table of the grand final of the EPT is Alexander Strandley, just 21 years old.
Hi, my name is Alexander Strandley. I'm 21 years old from Oslo, Norway. I qualified through 650 events on PokerStars. I'm not that nervous. I don't know why. I should be nervous. This is my first big event, meeting all the stars. I'm going to play my normal game, take it as it comes. I know there are some real strong players at the table, like Marcel Lusk, one of the best in the world. So I'm probably going to try to stay away from him.
We have just seen the face of our winner, but who's it going to be? So the big blinds are at 10,000, the small blinds 5,000, no free rides. The ante will be put in by every player 1,000. It's very interesting sort of to think of the different strategies here, John. We're not all going in with the same stack. Big stacks and short stacks, and that'll dictate this table, and it means we're going to get action early on, as if we're not excited enough.
Well, we're certainly going to do that because we've got, you know, Ross Boatman and Fraser Dunphy both need to... Oh, hello, Thierry Casals has woken up with Ace King very early on.
As you were saying,
like
John,
he needs the chips. Yeah, first, you know, he's first in chips now.
As you're saying, the small stacks will get busy. And Terry Casals knows that as well. And the head ace king with that stack in front of him, John, should be quite a considerable bet.
Oh yeah, I mean, it's a great hand to start with. You know, he's raised it by 30,000 up to 40,000. See if he gets any action. Oh, Fraser Dunphy's moved all in.
Fraser Dunphy's went OTT, and he's going to get a call, and he's going to be a massive underdog. So early on in the final table, we said one of these eight faces was going to be the EPT champion. We could be talking seven. Dunphy needs to buck the trend.
He's in such bad shape here, Colin. Really bad shape.
He looks like he works out about three times a week, John. On the table, right, here we go. That's not going to help him whatsoever at this stage, bar runner-runner clubs for him. No good. The ace-king stands. That's the best five card. And let's have a look at the turn. No card again for him. A four would make a split pot for a straight, John. That's unlikely. He's probably needing a jack to get... And he hits the jack!
That is lucky. Boy, that's lucky. You're probably going to win it now.
If Dunphy goes on to win this tournament, John, that hand will live with him forever. That'll be his turning point.
That's exactly the sort of thing that can, you know, it can happen sometimes in poker. You have a hand like that early on. There's his girlfriend, delighted. And there's Terry Casals suddenly feeling not so invincible.
Well, a big hand and possibly a turning point early on. Look at that, almost smug.
He's going to be feeling very, very happy there. Very happy.
But, you know, if poker's 80% skill and 20% luck, he's just had his bit of luck and his skill's going to come into play now.
Well, you know, he's doubled up. It's a great situation. He's doubled up against the chip, you know, the chip leader. Perfect, perfect start for him.
A few more sunglasses present at this final table. Everyone knows they're on camera all day. They want to look good. Another ace-king suited, this time in the hand of the boatman.
Let's see what he's going to do. He's waiting. Yeah.
Oh, he's got to get busy. Ross Boatman goes in with such a small stack in relation to how big these blinds are. Ace-king suited. It's a good bet. He may get some action. No cards we've seen so far warrants it.
It's the right bet, though, with Ace-king as well, because he doesn't want to, you know, he doesn't want to mess around with it. He hasn't got a big enough stack. I mean, a big enough hand. You know, it's nothing, you know, as the Irish call it.
He wants to be heads up. He wants to be heads up with one player. And will that player be Marcel Lusk?
I consider Ace King to be better than Jacks.
Okay. Back to Marcel, he's in a big blind. Ross is all in.
Still possible.
That's one queen. And another John.
Call.
Classic situation. Call. He's got a call.
Of course he's going to call, and he's favourite. And another man is walking the tightrope. This time it's Ross Boatman.
See if another short stack can double up. Oh,
well, this is some situation. It's a dream flop for the Boatman because he's now got his flush draw on the go. He's also hit his king top pair, two pair each player. Boatman's winning with the kings and threes. Only a queen can sink him. And there you go, it's his ace. He hits two pair, his king and his ace comes good. He had two over cards, the Lusk's pocket queens, even though Lusk went in his favourite. But it's Ross Boatman that doubles up. Two of the short stacks get busy early on, and it pays off. And they're being watched by so many big names, including Hendon Mob's very own Ram Faswani. He's not the only one here.
It's Joe's birthday today. I won't say how old. Joe, worse ways to spend your birthday than a Monte Carlo, isn't there?
Absolutely. It's wonderful to be here.
And what about the final table here? What are your predictions?
I have a favourite. Marcel Lusk is my favourite. He's a good friend of mine. I think the three danger players at the table are going to be Marcel, Jeff Williams, the American kid, and Ross Boatman. I'm hoping Marcel...
I mean, this, I think we probably told this story before. Lusk's glasses being on upside down is mainly just because people look at it and go, why is he wearing them upside down? Just something a bit different. And he says it helps him get reads off people. Just in case you're wondering. It's not a fashion statement. Here's three offsuit. They'll be thrown away.
I never thought you had any big ones. What about me? How much you rush? Go ahead. No, how much you rush?
No, you do it,
I thought.
That was really... Did you see that then, Colin? Marcel was about to raise, but before he'd made any action, Jeff, in his inexperience, Jeff Williams, because he's predominantly an internet player, says, I raise, before Marcel had done anything. As soon as Marcel realised the chip leader was going to do that, he folded his cards.
Well, let me tell you something. We've seen Jeff Williams in Monte Carlo. Pocket rockets. Let me just finish what I was going to say before Fraser makes his move. Jeff Williams knows what he was doing there.
And Fraser going to re-raise.
What will we do here, John? A small raise. He wants to keep Williams in.
Well, he hasn't really got that many chips, has he?
So you're going to throw.
He's only. I think he'll probably double. He'll probably double Williams' bet. I think you're right. I'm just trying to count how many of those yellow stacks he's got.
Let's see what he does.
Oh, he's re-raised by 70,000. Okay.
Williams might want to have a look at a flop with that. He's got enough chips in front of him. He's already put it. Oh, he's went all in. That's an internet play if ever there was one.
That's a bad. He should have known that Fraser Dumphy. He should have known, Jeff, really, Jeff. He should have known that he had a very big hand and a much bigger hand than tens.
Well, Dumphy's set for a double up again. He's got the best pre-flop hand that exists in the greatest card game in the world. And it's became the cruelest card game in the world. Dumphy in serious trouble. Even Fraser's having trouble smiling here. And he can only hit an ace to get out of jail. And that is not going to happen. What a hand.
That is so cruel.
Jeff Williams, an internet qualifier, makes a naive internet move and hits his trips. Dumphy finishes eighth in the greatest poker tournament Europe's ever seen. But it's a cruel, cruel exit. Seven left, and Williams, as if he needed him, takes all of Dumphy's chips.
Lucky Americans.
That is so unfortunate. He must have, after hitting the jack early on, he must have thought he had a very good chance here, Colin.
Maybe an hour or so's time, you've had a beer at the bar, you can relax a bit. You'll look back and laugh on that.
Yeah, it's true.
No
laughter. Bitterness, but I'll be over it.
There's no room for bitterness. You
no,
made the final
true,
table
true,
in Monte Carlo.
I'm not bitter at all. Just unlucky. It happens.
And why does it always seem to happen in pocket aces?
It's horrible, isn't it? But really horrible.
I think it doesn't happen anymore in pocket aces than any other premium hand, but you always remember them. They never go away. Whether you lose £5 in your living room or get put out in the final table here in the EPT Grand Final, you'll never forget when your pocket aces are beaten.
No, but here, though, really here, of all the places, you don't want it to be here. Oh, hello, Marcel's got king-queen. See what how he raises. It'll probably be 70,000 again because it's a similar hand to ace queen. Okay. He's interesting, Marcel, because he's always checks around the table to get a feel for what people feel about the amount that he's raising. You know what I mean? He's fiddling with his chips, getting feedback all the time. It's interesting.
He never gets lazy. That's one thing about him. He never clocks off.
No, never, ever. He's thinking and thinking and thinking.
Ace two suited again.
Well, yeah.
Cazales is playing a very tight game. He knows
really.
He's got chips in front of him.
It's a rubbish hand, really, Colin. I mean, it's not. You don't want to be.
It wasn't a big raise, John. It wasn't a big raise.
How many have you got, Marcel? Exactly, please.
After the hand or now?
Well, after the hand, you might have nothing, but how many have you got now?
You know, I was watching television.
195 more.
195 more?
I'd say, I'm only guessing.
No.
Okay, so Arshad Hussein is asking Marcel this how many chips he has in front of him. He says, I might not have anything, but I'm asking anyway. Don't noise him up. Don't annoy Lusk. That's my advice, Arshad.
Okay,
I'm all in.
Oh, he's all in. He's moved all in there, Colin. This is a great move. What a great move. He's spotted a weakness there. Either in the bet or in Marcel's reaction, he's pounced on him.
Will Marcel take the bait?
You will find out one way or the other. Or maybe I'll show the crowd.
He's fronting. He's almost fronting. He's doing everything but wave his finger in front of him here.
He really doesn't look comfortable. Arshad doesn't look comfortable, but Marcel can't call.
Which crowd are you going to show? Then I'm going to sit there.
He can't call. I mean, he knows he can't call, but if he'd had a pair, he'd have probably been able to do it.
It's a foolhardy, brave move by Arshad Hussein, and Lusk has been bruised twice, and he's not getting involved again. He knows king-queen is not the biggest hand in the world, and he's folding it.
That one?
This is the jack.
Which one do you want?
Yes, that one.
Tell me which one you want. This one?
Yeah.
Look, he's going to show him a card. He's shown him the five, look. He showed him a five. He's gone... This has told Marcel that he's gone over the back, over the top of him with... The best hand he could have is a pair of five.
So had me beat.
He probably did.
3-4 suited?
Now Marcel's thinking, what did he have?
I like when you show me the card.
I said I'll show you a card.
Wow. Marcel would have rather seen the jack there. He'd have said, oh, well, he's had a pair of jacks.
I can see you're in the mood for dancing.
I'm ready.
Oh, that's great.
A poker table is a much brighter place with Marcel Lusk on it, and Arshad is adding to the entertainment. He's just taken on the master. And you know, Lusk will not mind us saying and taking him down a peg or two.
I'll tell you something, though. Marcel will not be happy. 6-7 of hearts. This is a great hand. I mean, I'd call a big blind with that, for sure.
Quite an early position, though. You can... Karam's probably playing tighter than Kazal's.
Well, he's playing very tight, that's for sure.
What an interesting table we have here of players who are just playing all so tight. If they put a lump of coal up their backside, it would come out a diamond. And other players who are throwing caution to the wind and making some foolhardy moves.
Ah, but Thierry Casals here has decided that he wants to play some poker. He's getting the big chips out now. The orange chips there are 10,000.
The Frenchman wakes up. There you go. It's a blind steal.
He suddenly decided, oh, and Arshad with his pocket tens will definitely come over. Oh, he's just called.
Ooh, jack 10.
Oh, he didn't have pocket tens. I'm sorry, I misread that. I thought it had a 10. It's 10 jack of clubs. That's fair. That's fine.
Well, he's hit two pairs straight off the board. He doesn't have a spade, but Casals only has the five, so... he's not going to have a huge amount of confidence in that, even if he does hit his flush, John.
Well, Arshad will have to bet here, I think, because he, just in case Casals has got a king or the ace of spades.
The pot's just over 100,000. A bet of about 40,000 here from Arshad will let him know exactly where he is. And that's what he wants at the moment.
Well, he'd actually want his opponent to come over the top here. You're right, Colin.
35,000.
Yeah, nearly right, just about.
But Casals went all in here, and how can he have so much confidence in this?
Wow.
He's got nothing.
This is incredible, Colin. Casals has been playing like so solid, and suddenly he's made a move with a very weak flush draw.
We just saw a shot of Thierry's wife. She looked like she just swallowed a wasp. She can't stand this tension. We don't want to see a spade.
This will take Arshad out if a spade comes.
And he doesn't really deserve it in this hand, and it hasn't.
Yeah!
Another double three.
Wow, that was an incredible hand. This is really bizarre. I think Thierry Casals had suddenly made it, you know, in his mind he's been playing really, really solid. Suddenly he tries to steal the blind. And then Arshad quite rightly calls with 10 jack of clubs, hits his top two pair. Fascinating hand.
And he doubles up. More European Poker Tour after this break. A wonderful setting for a wonderful event, the European Poker Tour, and it's the big climax. Only one of these players will be drinking champagne. We've moved on a bit, a few hands have passed, so let's get you up to speed. We're now live with Joe Hashem, who's doing the card calling. G'day, mate! He's getting the pocket rockets, mate! He's a nice guy celebrating his birthday here in Monte Carlo.
Is he Irish? I thought he was Australian.
Irish. It sounded Australian.
Well, it sounded a little bit Australian, I suppose, yeah.
Sorry, Rory Bremner. Okay, 6-5 off suit. And Alexander Stradley folds those.
He's got a big stack now, Strandley, after that encounter with Jeff Williams.
Well, what a bizarre game Jeff Williams has played so far, and he raises this time with really good cards. Ace, queen suited. Ross Boatman's having a look. Now, Ross Boatman's in this situation where as the blinds move around the table, his stack's diminishing again, his early double up's becoming insignificant, and he needs to get busy.
Yeah, but not, I'm not sure he wants to get busy with this hand.
Right, he's surveying the table. He knows Cazales will need to have a very big hand to do something because he's been very conservative, bar one rush of blood to the head.
But pocket twos are pretty horrible, let's face it. Now, Cazales should throw this in the bin. Oh, he's not, he's raising.
I'm interested. Cazales' game's just changed. He's went from first gear to fifth gear.
Well, he's gone from chip leader to, you know, it's a huge loss against Arshad. You know, playing really, really solid, and now suddenly he wants to re-raise an early raiser with ace-jack.
And what a re-raise it is. Another 100,000.
OK, so nothing there for Arshad.
I mean, what Cazales is doing is making the decisions very easy for the rest of his table.
Well, yeah, assuming that the rest of the table hasn't got anything, but what's going to be interesting to see is if it gets back, you know, if it gets back round to Jeff, which it has, what's he going to do? Ace-queen is not that big a hand. You know, he's up against Cazales, who's been playing very tight, but having said that, he just went all in with three, you know, 3-5 or three deuce or whatever it was beforehand.
Well, the way Jeff Williams is playing, I wouldn't be surprised if he went over the top.
He may well do. Look, he doesn't look that comfortable, Thierry Cazales.
He doesn't, and maybe Williams will see that.
You know, but it could be a false tell. You know, you've got to work, trying to work these things out. Is it a false tell? Has he got a huge hand? I'm in an early position, I've raised, and now this guy wants to come over the top of me, and all I've got is ace-queen. What am I going to do? What can I do here? Okay.
Oh. Well,
Jeff has announced that he's all in for 198,000 more.
To be precise, Jeff.
Well, he's played it very strongly. You know, he could have... No, he's... I don't believe he's calling. I don't believe that he's calling this.
Well, maybe Cazales sees this as the best cards he's had in a while, and he's going to roll the dice and see what happens. Well, will Lady Luck be shining on him? Not so far it won't. Jeff Williams willing the cards to fall in his favour. It means that much to him, and so far he's in a great position. Here comes the river, and it leaves Cazales high and dry. Another dent is chip stack and a call. As you said, John, pre-flop, he shouldn't have made.
I cannot believe that a 740,000 euro pot developed with two such mediocre hands. It's incredible. It's unbelievable.
Well, you can hear the talk, John. You can hear the talk around here. His parents are happy to see him double up, but let's face it, both players didn't play that well.
Well, I mean, Thierry's eyes have got to throw his hand away or do what he did, which was re-raise. But then suddenly Jeff Williams moves all in, and Thierry called without even thinking. I mean, I'm astonished. If he'd thought about it, he'd thought, well, what am I up against here? I could be up against ace-king. I could be up against, well, ace-queen, you know. It's amazing, really.
If he's going in against pocket sevens, he's still 2% off being a 50-50 shot.
Yeah, but he'd rather see pocket sevens than ace-queen, obviously. But I find that quite incredible. Suddenly it all has exploded. People have seemed to be playing a little bit too fast. The blinds are not that high. You know, there's still a lot of play left in this tournament.
Well, listen, that's what happens when you're playing on the biggest ever final table in European poker history.
Well, you think the pressure is getting to them?
I think it would get to everyone at this table, maybe with exception of Marcel Lusk.
Best chance to get chips. Understand?
Well, Marcel's just not in a good situation.
I haven't been looked.
I know.
You want me to look first?
I don't really want you to call.
He knows that Mark Karam knows that he's almost got to call with any hand because he's got very few chips left.
Well, that's exactly what he'll need to do. It's a raise to cover. Marcel Lusk. So Marcel Lusk is all in with a pair of putts, a pair of eights. He's got the snowman.
I do hope these stand up. I really hope these stand up, Colm, because I'll be honest with you, Karen's made a really bad play here.
Okay, the flop is fantastic so far for Marcel Lusk, who on the big blind has got the pocket eights. Oh. Well, a seven at this stage is no big deal whatsoever. Karam is not. Oh!
Oh my word.
A full house for Mark Karam. And an early victim. And the final table is the most experienced player. The Dutch poker artist that is Marcel Lusk will not be European Poker Tour Grand Champion.
Oh, he deserved so much more, Marcel. So much more.
Well, he's sick as a parrot. Unlucky to go out, and every player at that table, now Marcel's gone, will fancy it.
I know that you might not be in the mood, but I also know that you've got a beautiful voice. Will you sing to us?
No. How can I say no if yes like this?
Oh.
But I can say, I know they said that I am leaving, but I just couldn't say goodbye. It's only 1 year away.
Beautiful.
Still be second in chance.
Noah looked kind of awkward there.
Oh, he's a great poker player, but he's no Frank Sinatra.
So the small blind, 7,500. Big blind, 15,000.
Everyone will pay an ante. Jeff Williams throws away 5-3 suited. And 10-6 suited may be as good as our friend Ross Boatman's going to get. And he's moved all in for what it's worth. He didn't want to be blinded out. He's going to take his chance. And let's see, does he get a call? John, everyone will know he's short stacked. He doesn't want to come up against this.
Yeah, he had to make a move. And he wanted to make a move while he still had a stack big enough to make people fold.
Well, it looks like at this stage he's going to go home. He needs that two pair or to see some clubs come out. He's not going to see that now. Needs to hit tens and sixes here in the last two cards. Four's not even going to make any straight possibilities. And we're going to say goodbye to Ross Boatman. An insult to injury on the river when he hits his 10. He came in so short stacked and he made an admirable effort here to take the EPT crown in sixth place from a man with so little chips. It's not a bad result at all. Welcome back to World Poker, Ross Boatman.
Yeah, he won't be happy, but he'll be content, I think.
So this is where we stand. Mark Karam, Jeff Williams, Thierry Casals, Arshad Hussain and Alexander Strandley, all over the knowledgeable gaze of Greg Raymer, who's taken over the card calling. And we see some bizarre hands, some great hands. Let's see where it pans out from here.
OK, slight increase in the blinds there. 10,000, 20,000.
And the ante standing at 2,000, is that right? Yes.
And that's it.
Ace 4 offsuit.
OK, so it's just over three times blind.
Casals only has a little over 100,000 chips, and that's the right move to make, John. He's all in with the ace 10 of clubs and in decent shape if this goes heads up. But we've seen Williams before with hands worse than this, and he's taken the chips.
Well,
he's going to call it. Williams will call this. The way he's been playing so far, there's no way he's ducking out of this hand.
Well, he doesn't really have to put that much more in. Yeah. There we go. Yeah, he's gambling with a pretty horrible hand against Casals' hand.
You're right, it doesn't have a big kicker. The spades is what Williams would be looking here. He knows he's in with a shout, Williams, but again, he's calling when he knows he's going in behind. Let's see what the flop brings. That's a really nice flop for Casals. He's now got his flush draw as well. And a straight draw, an inside straight draw. Really good shape. That balances it up now. No way is Williams going to hit runner-runner spades here. What a cruel way to go out if he does. He doesn't want to see a four either. What does he say? Oh, that's cruel.
Oh, my word.
This may be the biggest.
That is unbelievable.
This may be the biggest final table in European poker history. It is also the most cruel.
Oh, his wife looked really upset. I mean, that is horrible. What a horrible outdraw. Horrible. I mean, even his four of clubs was killed on that, you know, on the flop. He only had two outs, apart from a runner flush.
Well, off he goes. He can talk about it, but he's gone. We're down to four. Welcome back to Monte Carlo and the PokerStars.com European Poker Tour. And here we go, four players left at the end of the season, and Jeff Williams, nearly a million and a half chips as the lead. Alexander Stanley, just over half that amount. Sole British interest from Arshad Hussain for Accrington. And it's Mark Karam that needs to get busy. America, Canada, Norway, and England. Four players left in Monte Carlo. I mean, we call it the European Poker Tour. This is world famous, just like you, John.
And we've got four players now. Every round is costing 38,000. They've got to start playing poker now.
And every hand's worth more with it just being four-handed, so we'll see. Well, not that it matters much with William still at the table. Eight-handed, these type of hands were worth a lot to him. So both suited, so the flop's very important. Let's take a look how it pans out. Well, Williams has his flush draw. And he checks it and has a look. And he's now hit his flush. Karam with a gut shot straight, which means absolutely nothing. Williams has checked this the whole way through. He's going to bet it now. Slow playing the flush, John. New tactics from Williams.
Yeah, I don't think he wouldn't have got any money out of it anyway on the flop, even if he bet it on his flush draw on the flop. I think Karam's got to fold, and he would have done anyway. He's not going to get called here, so...
Even 50,000 is too much. He can't call.
Yeah, straight, flush. Why'd you bet so much?
Nah. Karam already smells the rat. He's gone.
Yeah, why do you bet so much? He's not going to call.
Oh, what's he doing? Well, what's he doing?
He can beat. He could have beat. He could have beaten a total bluff. But Karam said himself. He said, "Why do you bet so much? What do you got, a straight or a flush?" He said it himself. He smelt a rat and then called.
Well, that's the parents of Jeff Williams. We've showed them before. We'll show them again if this guy keeps going the way he is. He has a wee look up at them. He's only 19 years old, so his parents need to be here.
Yeah. That is deuce.
50-50, it's good there.
Yeah.
He tells him honestly what he had in his hand.
Yeah.
This is interesting at this stage of the biggest tournament Europe's ever seen. There you go. Big blind's 20,000, small blind 10,000. The point of making about 19-year-old Jeff Williams is too young to gamble in America. Too young to do a lot of things in America. And unlike a strip bar, you can't get on the EPT with fake ID.
Stanley's playing quite tight, but Karam's got to get moving here.
Good luck.
And that's exactly what he does with a terrible, terrible hand. Well, it's an arrogant call almost. He knows Karam was trying to move on him.
Oh, I'm in big trouble.
He is in big trouble, you're right. And we look like we could be losing the Canadian, John.
Yeah, he's not in good shape. Arshad's looking happy because he knows he's probably going to come a third. Wow.
Arshad's very happy. Okay.
Karam's hit his five, though.
A six as well. A six is a great card. Sixes, fives, and eights. All good.
This does not give Mark any further outs. He still needs a five for trips, an eight for two pair, or a six for a straight.
Oh, he doesn't hit it whatsoever. Two pair for Karam in the end. One on boards and the five in his hands. So the over pair of Williams stands up. The hand goes according to form, and the Canadian Mark Karam, who came in here in fifth position and was one of five online qualifiers, finishes in fourth place. You can tell he's very, very happy with that. That'll get him a few more snappy suits.
Yeah, no, he seems very happy. Fourth is not a bad, you know, it's not a bad place.
And Williams adds to his chip stack. looking like a strong favourite.
Are you surprised about how calm and confident Jeff seems to be? He's only 19 and he's sort of dictating things out there at the moment,
yeah,
isn't he?
Yeah, well, he is very confident. I mean, he has more chips than all of us combined. So, I mean, he's just raising every hand. And, I mean, nobody can challenge him unless they've got a monster. And four-handed, you don't get dealt a monster very often. So he's just running everybody over.
Well, he has two more obstacles in his way. Jeff Williams, a big chip leader at this stage. And as if they need it, the big blind's now 24,000. Arshad Hussain, well, he'll be elated at third place. Maybe second place. Maybe if he gets busy, he could be EPT champion. The last British interest here.
Not sure I like that call, though. I prefer to raise with that hand. I don't really want to call with it.
We're three-handed, especially.
Yeah, you want to raise. Your king's probably winning anyway at that stage. Oh, hello. And he's just checked, Williams. That I would have raised with that.
Well, the flop comes out. He's got an open-ended straight draw. Nobody hits a pair. Okay. And Arshad bets it. It's probably a wise move.
Just tries to steal it.
And will Williams call it with the open-ended straight draw? He's got enough chips.
Well, he's only bet 30,000. Of course he's going to call.
He'll just have a look. He'll look for the 10, he'll look for the 5, and if he hits it...
He'll probably, if he hits an ace, he probably thinks his ace is good.
Okay. Follows it up. Arshad is saying a quite shaky 30,000 thrown into the fray. And again, he'll call it. He's getting free cards almost with that stack.
Arshad's making it very cheap for him.
Okay, well, it's worked out very well indeed.
Wow, Arshad's got a call here. He's got the king high flush.
Only beaten by the ace. He knows that, and the ace isn't in the hand of Williams. It's a no-brainer.
That diamond help you?
Very good situation for Arshad Hussain. And the loose play of Williams is now going to start to tell if he starts handing too many chips over to a player like Arshad Hussain. Or indeed Alexander Strandley.
Well, he's got to call there.
There's no decision.
No.
He's going to double up. Well done, Arshad. What do you mean, ah? A seven of diamonds would have done him, son. Oh, dear.
Time to play, boys. 246.
246. You were never thinking about crossing, right? Thank you. Jeff Williams does a very good job of playing dumb at times. Asking Arshad is he going to fold the King of Diamonds and that three-handed. Not going to happen. You can't talk about what's going through these players' heads. And John, they're young boys. You got to give them a bit of leeway. Do you remember being young once? The boy's 21.
That's only 20 years ago.
Just 8 years ago for me, but never mind. Stranley with 10-9, unsuited connectors. See what Arshad fancies doing.
Arshad might think he's just steaming after that last hand, which is possible.
Sorry, I was looking at the two young blonde ladies behind him.
Yeah, you would be. Here we are, the biggest poker tournament in Europe, and you're looking at two blonde girls.
I'm just trying to remember that the one on the left remembered to lift her shoes out of my room this morning.
Morning.
Exactly the same move he made against Marcel earlier on, except he had Jack Deuce then, I think it was a Jack 5. No, Jack 5. Now he's got the Jack 6, suddenly he moves all in. He's obviously got good tells on these players. You know, he's maybe thought Stranley's better, you know, not that big an amount here. He doesn't look that comfortable. If I move all in, maybe I can. And he's playing a really solid player, hardly played any hands. If he hasn't got aces, kings or queens, he'll probably lay it down.
He's also watched this guy take ace jack and check it the whole way to the river, heads up.
Yeah, exactly. All these little bits of information are going through. There he is, and he wins.
Arshad Hussain wears the trousers at this final table at the moment. More chips for the man who, more and more, is looking like the likely contender to Jeff Williams. We're back after the break. We're very close to finding a winner in Monte Carlo. last time, welcome back. Our final fling in Monte Carlo on the European Poker Tour. And our winner is nigh. 24,000 in the big blind. We're going to see a lot of action given the stacks that are out there. Our Shadow Sane's on a bit of a roll at the moment, but it's going to take one hell of a roll to take those chips off Jeff Williams. And the overcautious Alexander Stradley, for me, is next to go, John.
I think so. I think even he's got to play this hand. King 8 suited. You know, it's costing him 42,000 a round.
So 25,000 raise. Oh, what a hand for Stradley. Jeff Williams nonchalantly calls all in, and he can afford to do that with such a big chip stack. Stradley's got to call this.
Well, he's got 1.75 million. Call. You've got to call. Of course you've got to call.
Well, he's in a wonderful position here in terms of if the clubs come out. But altogether, it's four live cards. As much chance of a queen coming out here as a king. Well, the flop comes down. Ah, there's no flush availabilities now.
No help.
Ace doesn't help anyone, so Stradley's king is going to stand
on.
Another river for Jeff Williams.
Oh, he's been lucky when he needs to be. That's taken Arshad into second place. Stradley finishes third. He's hitting cards now, Colin.
He's been hitting cards the whole final table. His mum claps on Jeff. But it's Alexander Stradley who bites the dust. Jeff Williams, surely an unassailable lead at this stage. Arshad will need to start bullying. Two players left.
Hi, I'm Jeff Williams. I'm 19 years old from Atlanta, Georgia.
My name's Arshad Hussain. I'm from Accrington, and I'm 31.
Oh, I'm so excited. When I first played the online qualifier, I never thought for a minute that I'd even do well in that. And then I got here, and I didn't expect to make it past day one. And day one turned into day two, and day two turned into day three, and now I'm at the final table. And it's been the most incredible experience of my life.
I haven't got enough chips to be bullied around anyway. If he makes a move on me and I've got a hand, I'm just going to play. I'm going to play what I get, so then I won't be hanging about there. I'll double up or I'll be out of there.
He's still here.
He's more than doubled up as well.
Well, albeit though, he's still got less than half of the chips Jeff Williams has, but we're heads up. So we're all in situation and that changes. Okay. Well, it's very tense here, and I mean, there's not a seat available. Not even standing room here in Monte Carlo. To see who's going to win the biggest poker tournament in European poker history.
Let's see how he plays. Sorry to interrupt, Colin, but let's just see how he plays his hand. How much?
Okay. Another 48,000, John, on top of the blind.
Throw it away. Arshad, just throw it away.
He's going to call it.
Well, he shouldn't. You know, that's really, he knows he's up against a big hand. He should just wait until you've got, you know. Okay, 8, 10 looks nice, but really isn't that much.
Well, the flop does him no favours whatsoever, so he should be able to get away from this hand. Jeff Williams, well, it's not happening for Arshad, is it? Jeff Williams is going to take more chips. I don't think, as you said, John, like the last hand, nothing more than what's in.
See what comes now. And now he hits his ace. Oh, he can't miss. Williams cannot miss. And now, you know, he can't hit his queen, obviously, now. But he's certainly going to bet it. I doubt that Arshad's going to call with his middle pin straight draw.
It would be a shame if this is how Arshad started down the slippery slope to second place. Let's hope he throws those cards away and we'll find another day. Not this hand, Arshad, I'm afraid. Good fold.
Good fold.
Do you know what? He's got gears, Arshad Hussain. He's went up and down the gears in this final table. And he's certainly showed different levels and a dexterity today in his play.
No, I agree. He's been certainly up and down.
Here on merit. Jeff Williams has got lucky a few times, it has to be said. Well, they're playing for a case of money and a trophy. It's stuff childhood dreams are made of, isn't it? Who would have known 10, 15 years ago just how big this game would be and that we'd be sitting here now with €900,000 going to one player?
I mean, it's hard to believe they look so calm, but 900,000, this is a life-changing amount of money for both these players.
Okay, we've got Jeff Williams with a 10-3. This is a typical heads-up hand. Nothing great out there. But Hussein's got unsuited connectors. And see how the flop comes out. He's got a middle pin straight. Bottom pair for Williams. He's got a fancy. He's in a good position. But no betting whatsoever. We're going to see the turn yet again. A very slow hand.
You know, Williams is a big favourite.
Ah.
Oh, wow. Straight in the middle. Hussein hits the nuts.
Well, at last.
3, 4, 5, 6, 7. See if you can get any money out of him. I suspect he won't.
Well, he's checked it all the way to the river, so he might get something. Let's have a small bet. Yes, 50,000. That's probably as much as he could go here, John. Oh, Williams might not think he has. Williams might think a raise would do the job here. He calls it, and Hussein gets probably as much as he could have got out of that pot.
I think Williams just called for information there. I think he wanted to see, you know, he wanted to see his hand. If you're sitting in front of nearly 2 million chips, you're thinking, oh, what's 50,000?
Chuck him in.
Yeah.
It's as much as Hussein could have made out of that hand. Anything else, with such a bad pair in Williams' hand, it wouldn't have paid anything. So it may seem like you made a small bet, but that was the right bet.
And you and I both know, Colin, that, you know, a lot of those small bets adding up, you know, suddenly you've got 10 of them and it's 500,000, you're getting back in there.
Well, are we any closer to finding a European Poker Tour Grand Final champion? Well, Jeff Williams with the chips and now with Ace 10. Let's see what goes along with that 8. Oh, it's Ace 8 for Arshad, and he's went all in. This could be the last hand of the European Poker Tour, and that could be our champion.
You want to play a big pot with those two? How many you got?
Count them up.
Count them up. Too.
Well, what he'll tell him is 696,000 chips. Maybe it'll be Arshad Hussein who locks out here going in as the dog, and then it would be game on. But he will get called by Jeff Williams with ace 10. No doubt, John, he'll call this.
Oh, I think he's definitely going to call.
This is all entertainment value.
The bet is actually, the raise is 644,000.
And a total of 696.
We're here to gamble, aren't we? We're here to gamble.
Well, everyone watches on. And if this crowd knew what we knew, they'd know it might be very, very close to going home time here in Monte Carlo. €900,000 to the winner. He will call this.
I call.
And he does.
Yeah, he did. Yep, you were right, Colin. Yep.
We could be looking at a 19-year-old European Poker Tour champion. He's already punched the air. He knows he's in great shape. Your son could be €900,000 richer after this flop. John, it gives a middle pin straight draw. That's why the hands are going to the head of Jeff. Because Hussein has got more outs than he had before. A bigger chance of winning this hand. One card for the glory. 19-year-old Jeff Williams. His one card from going from being a University of Georgia student to a millionaire, and that's exactly what he is. Over $1 million, €900,000, and the young American, too young to gamble in his home country, is the champion of Europe.
Unbelievable. Unbelievable. 19 years old.
A tear in the eye of his mum, who can give up her job as an Anne Robinson impersonator. She's getting a new house. And Arshad Hussein, delightful second place. But there's her champion, Jeff Williams. Unbelievable. Natalie caught up with him at the presentation.
Congratulations. Well done, Jeff. You come over here.
Jeff, here's your check for 900 grand. Not bad for a 19-year-old, eh?
No, my gosh, not at all. It still is unbelievable.
Now, Jeff, you qualified online, and the last few days has been a bit of a whirlwind. Did you ever expect to be sitting at this table, let alone winning?
To be sitting at this table? I never expected to make it past the first day.
And all of a sudden, first day turned into second day, turned into the third day, turned into this, turned into a win. It's been an amazing journey.
Another big round of applause, please, ladies and gentlemen.
To put it into perspective, that check he's holding is about $130 for every day he's been in this earth. But more importantly, he's got to get the trophy, and he'll get it from Joe Hashem, of all players, probably one of his heroes. And that's it for the second season of the European Poker Tour. What an ending. Farewell from myself, Colin Murray, and the legendary John Duthie. The EPT Season 2's over. We got to start planning Season 3. This was the biggest poker tournament ever in Europe. The next one will be bigger. Join us for it.